You can see the slide, Ravindra. Unmute. Please unmute. Ravindra, you have to unmute. You're muted. Unmute on your desktop. Can you hear us? Can you unmute yourself? Can you unmute?
Yes, ma'am.
If there's any problem, we can hear you.
Madam, hear am you, I Ravindra? Audible, madam?
You're audible.
Yes,
can you see the slides?
Yeah, yeah, madam. I am able to see, madam.
Okay, there are two projections. You can see there are two of you appearing. Just see that one is switched off.
Yeah, yes, madam. I am.
Okay, you can start taking up the case for discussion.
Okay, madam. Can I read, madam? Can I?
Yeah, please start reading and in between we'll question you.
Okay, madam. Good evening, madam. This is a 68-year-old male, came with complaints of yellowish discoloration of eyes and urine for past 1 month, associated with a generalized fatigability and tiredness for 1 month, and also associated with pale stools for past 15 days. There was no history of fever, pain abdomen, pruritus. There was also history of loss of appetite and weight loss of about 5 kg for 4 months, and there was no bowel and bladder disturbances.
So, any other questions that you would like to know for this patient? What are the things that cross your mind? What are the important things that cross your mind and you think there's some deficiency in this way?
Madam, by going through this history, I came to know that there is an obstructive jaundice is there, madam, which is of more of obstructive jaundice. We don't know whether it is. I would like to know about prodromal symptoms, madam.
Exactly.
Whether it is there, whether to delineate between intrahepatic and extrahepatic.
Exactly. So when you get a patient like this, the first and foremost is you must rule out other causes of polycystic jaundice. What information you get from this is there is some sort of a
jaundice is there.
There is some polystasis as evidenced by the pale stool. So,
yes,
we cannot from this history say that is intrahepatic or extrahepatic.
Extra.
So, what are the few intrahepatic causes that can mimic this particular type of jaundice and that should get excluded?
Intrahepatic causes, madam.
Intrahepatic.
Madam, most common is a toxin related alcohol, madam. Alcohol also can.
Alcohol never causes polycystic jaundice. No, we keep discussing.
Viral hepatitis A can cause. Okay.
So one is viral hepatitis.
Viral hepatitis A can cause.
Number two would be drug-induced liver injury.
Drug-induced liver injury.
These are the two important causes of intrahepatic polycystic.
Very important. Preceding history of any drug.
Yeah. So history of drugs are important, and prodromal symptoms are important.
Symptoms.
Usually, jaundice due to alcohol. When you have plain jaundice, yes, alcohol history will come in. But when there's some evidence of pale stool and with other symptoms, then alcohol will really not fit into this.
Okay.
What are the two or three important points that you would ask to know whether it is intrahepatic or extrahepatic? That will give you a clear, distinct difference between intrahepatic and extrahepatic cholestasis.
Madam, intrahepatic will be having prodromal symptoms. Prodromal symptoms, madam, like easy fatigability, and this easy fatigability will be there, and fever might be there, madam, one month.
That is prodromal symptoms.
And the extra hepatic, most probably fever will be there, madam, associated with fever, abdomen pain, fever with chills.
So, Yeah, so two important questions that you always ask for extrahepatic is pain, abdominal pain, and fever.
Fever.
What are the causes of pain in extrahepatic biliary obstruction?
Extrahepatic biliary.
What types of pain can you get?
Is a biliary pain, madam. Obstruction secondary to the galls, colitopolithiasis we can get, madam. Intracolic abdominal pain. Another is a dull aching pain. If there is a prolonged obstruction is there will be a congestion of the liver will be there, madam. So that there will be a stretching of the capsule will be there, madam.
So we call it as a discomfort. So more than a pain, it could be called as a discomfort.
Discomfort.
So what I always say is when there's a slow stretch, you get a discomfort.
Yes.
When there's an acute stretch, such as an outflow tract
obstruction,
or in patients with acute viral hepatitis, then you get a sudden stretch of the capsule, then you can get a pain.
Okay.
So I think you're describing, trying to distinguish a pain from a discomfort.
Yes.
Okay, a slow stretch, a gradual stretch, like an obstructive jaundice, will be more of a discomfort. Whereas a sudden stretch due to extrahepatic, either due to venous outflow tract obstruction or due to acute viral hepatitis, you can get a sudden onset of an acute pain. So I think that is important. So pain and fever is often due to cholangitis. So whenever you get, can you get fever due to intrahepatic cholestasis?
No, madam.
Never say no.
Madam, sorry, madam. It like a tropical hepatitis might be like malaria, leptospira, strep typhus. These can cause fever.
So what are the causes of intrahepatic conditions presenting with fever?
Madam, malaria, falciparum malaria, madam.
Infection.
Yeah. Infections, malaria.
Malaria causes fever because of not related to fever.
Yes.
We're talking of liver causing fever, liver pathology causing fever. And an infection. So what are the conditions when you can get fever with your liver pathology? Say liver abscess.
Liver abscess.
Hydatid cyst rupturing into the biliary tract. Okay. Then ascariasis in the biliary tract.
Ascariasis in the biliary tract.
So liver abscess, pyogenic liver abscess, all these. So infections are the ones that can cause fever. So tuberculosis will have low grade fever. Then sepsis. Cholangitic abscess, they can fever. So pain and fever can occur in both intra and extrahepatic, but the differences in the fever and the pain may give you a clue that you're dealing with this. The second most important or the third important point is the onset. Is the onset insidious or it is all of a sudden? So if you have an insidious onset, slow progressive onset with a prodromal, you again favor intrahepatic. Whereas if it is insidious onset, but all of a sudden, like this patient, it is all of a sudden.
Yes.
Until 1 month back, patient is normal. Suddenly, in the 1 month back, he has a yellowness, pulse, and urine, and fatigability. The fatigability and tiredness could be due to what all? What are the causes of fatigue and tiredness? One is he may be taking lesser food because something like in our society, the first is we stop all the food items and the patient will be living only on curd rice. So that is one is it just be having, number one.
Yes.
Number two, if it's a pathology like a pancreatic carcinoma, then there could be losing of the blood and there can be a fatigue.
Yes.
Can be fatigue and tiredness. Okay.
Yes.
So fatigue and tiredness may be part and parcel of the same disease state. Alright?
Okay.
And there's loss of weight and loss of appetite. Now, this loss of weight and loss of appetite, what are the other conditions when you can get yellow discoloration, the eyes and loss of weight and loss of appetite? And just note this, the weight loss is preceding the onset of jaundice. Make a note of that. So your chief complaint is weight loss of 4 kilos, 5 kilos over 4 months. And jaundice is more recent. So what are the things that can cause this type of a presentation? Then can you have a loss of weight and loss of appetite? One is, always remember common things are common. So first is systemic disease, number one. Number two, it could be, it's all in the COVID period. So maybe there's stress. Patient has got mental stress. He's got this thing. So he starts eating less. And therefore there's loss of weight and loss of appetite. But that will come as the last cause. Okay, all these organic causes will come number one, and all the other psychological functional causes will come as much later.
Okay.
So let's or what are the other things that you should ask if a person has loss of weight and loss of appetite for 4 months? One is systemic diseases like tuberculosis. So, type of fever, is there any rise of temperature?
Yes.
Those are. What are the GI causes when a person can have weight loss and loss of appetite for 4 months? Antedating the onset of jaundice.
Madam, any malignants involving the stomach also can cause.
Exactly. So therefore, what questions would you ask?
Madam, early satiety can be
caused. Early satiety. The nausea, vomiting, and difficulty in swallowing. All these symptoms will be a pointer towards a gastric malignancy. Okay? So switched off. What happened?
Can this be primarily sclerosing cholangitis?
Ravindra, answer.
Can this be primary sclerosing cholangitis?
Yes.
Can this be primary sclerosing cholangitis? What will be the presentation? The question like this is asked to tell what will be the presentation of a PSC. What will be the presentation?
PSC generally presents with jaundice will be there, madam. Pruritus will be there. Jaundice and pruritus.
And
easy fatigability will be there.
Okay, what else?
Cholangitis, what is the more common presentation? When you say cholangitis. Fever, right?
Fever.
Hello.
Can't hear you.
Madam, am I audible, madam?
You're audible now. You're
hello.
Fever. We can hear you.
Okay.
You're not
able to hear
us. Are you able to hear us? If you're not able to hear,
madam, I am able to hear you.
Yeah, please act fast. So, sir is asking you a question. Can it be a PSC? So, answer to that.
PSC, unlikely, sir.
Whenever you ask a question, if this can be this, you have to say what is the classical presentation of that.
Exactly.
Is the current presentation fitting into that or not?
Exactly.
So you have to say that classically, primary sclerosing cholangitis will present with recurrent episodes of fever, associated cholestasis in the form of pruritus
and
tail stools.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, sir.
So is the in this patient that is not there? No, there is no fever. Classically, there would be recurrent episodes of
sir.
Unless you are saying that, but can you deny? No. If this can be the first presentation of primary sclerosing cholangitis, maybe he will develop recurrent episodes of fever over a period of time. Okay. So based on this history, we can only say that there is some cholestatic jaundice since there is some weight loss.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, since there is some weight loss, we would like to keep the possibility of malignancy, possibility of systemic diseases. And what is the importance of progression of jaundice? How is the progress of jaundice help you to distinguish between medical causes and surgical causes?
Hello?
Rapid progress, short progress.
Yes, sir. Sir, rapid progress, obstruction is, if there is an obstruction also, malignancy, there will be a rapid progression, sir. In fluctuating, depending upon the how it progresses. If there some malignancy like a periampullary, there will be a fluctuating jaundice. But in some malignancies like pancreatic head carcinoma, there will be an unabating progression,
sir,
without any fluctuating. Hello.
We can hear.
In stone disease, you cannot have a rapid onset of jaundice.
Yes, sir. Stone disease also it will be happening, sir. But there will be a fluctuation will be there, sir, in stones.
Why? Why should there be a fluctuation of jaundice with stone?
Sir, right.
Only if it is an incomplete obstruction.
Incomplete obstruction.
But if the stone is impacted in the distal CBD and there's an associated stricture, which is commonly seen in gallstone disease, these patients can have a progressive jaundice.
Yes.
It can be, especially in the elderly. We do find they present very, very close mimicker. 68-year-old male presenting with this, You will need for a self-rise when you do an ultrasound, there will be multiple stones stacked in the CBD. And these patients don't even get fever because there are those immune suppressed patients who do not present fever, but present just like this, no fever, no pain, and they have progressive jaundice, and most of the time they will be having associated small stricture in the distal CBD or a large stone that's infected lower down. Dr. Salman, is it right?
Okay. Yeah. And but also keep in mind that if the stone passes, so in that case, they will never present with jaundice in the first place. It would more of be a biliary pain, which has subsided. So they would not. So either they would have jaundice or they would not have jaundice.
Okay.
It's unlikely that they will have intermittent jaundice unless you have intrahepatic cholelithia stone, something of that sort. Then you can have this kind of picture, recurrent stone. Fever or recurrent jaundice.
Okay.
Yeah. Degree of jaundice, based on the degree of jaundice, will you be able to distinguish? How does it help you? Deep jaundice.
Sir, if it is more than, if it is more than 10, generally likely to be malignant, sir.
More than?
More than 10 milligram.
Okay, so we are still at history. So an educated patient may be able to tell you that I checked my LFT and this is my bilirubin. So otherwise, it is fairly subjective when you say that. Okay, but yes, whenever you have a deep jaundice and which progresses rapidly, you have to think, keep in mind the possibility of a surgical jaundice, especially malignancy. Unless you talk about a rapid decompensation or an acute liver failure. So you do have medical causes also for a rapid progression of jaundice. So that also you have to keep in mind.
Okay, sir.
Should we move on to the next patient?
Sure.
There was no history of
CAM intake or NSAID abuse over the counter. There was no history of similar complaints in the past or in the family. There was no habit of consuming alcohol or cigarettes or substance abuse. There was no history of surgeries in the past or blood transfusions in the past.
What is the importance of all this? The last one, no history of surgery.
Madam, history. Yes, madam, surgery, previous history of surgery might be a biliary stricture might be the possibility is there, madam.
What type of surgery? What surgery can result in this type of a complication? We can't hear you. Cannot hear you. We're not able to hear you. Ravindra, we're not able to hear, not audible. There's some problem with your system. Can you just get it rectified? In the meantime, I'll ask someone else to take over. Praveen, you want to take over until he comes back? Praveen? Damodar, you can just take over since no one is willing.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. The surgery, details, why should we ask for details of surgery?
Past history of cholecystectomy, ma'am.
Yeah, so when can you expect cholecystectomy in a presentation like this? Within what period of time?
Even if cholecystectomy done even up to 5 years can present as a benign stricture, may not be in the recent past, ma'am.
2 years, no? Within two years of cholecystectomy, you can get ischemic strictures and they can present in this manner. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
And then importance of family history. What's the importance of family history? Why should you ask for a family history? So in northern parts of the country where you have high incidence of gallbladder cancer, it is important because gallstone disease runs in families. They do have histories of cholecystectomies. There are histories of families with gallbladder cancer. So therefore, family history is also equally important, number one. Number two, hemolytic anemias. They run in families. They can be associated with stone disease. And the stone disease can again cause obstruction and again present as cholestatic jaundice. So I think all these are equally important, okay?
Yeah.
And high-risk behavior, is it important? Not at age 68, but still, high-risk behavior.
if you're thinking about intrahepatic cholestasis, ma'am, in case of a viral reactivation of hepatitis B.
No, AIDS-related cholangiopathy, those are the things that you start now.
Yes.
That's important. So age-related cholangiopathy can also present as obstructive jaundice. And do not forget the IgG4. So these are the other important differentials that we should not forget in patients with obstructive jaundice. Okay,
yes. Dr. Sharanath,
can you just ask you questions and then
we... Yeah. So, important thing is one, understand whether it is a painful jaundice or painless jaundice. Usually, if it is painful jaundice, you're thinking in terms of a surgical cause of the jaundice. That, in if it is surgical jaundice, it will tell you whether you have progression of jaundice, and weight loss will tell you whether it is you're keeping the possibility of malignancy higher up or stone disease. And in medical causes, you look at predominantly the prodrome. It is important to look at the timing of the prodrome. If it is correlating just with the start of the jaundice, or the prodrome has started much longer. If the prodrome has been much longer, then you have to keep the possibility of a cholangiocarcinoma as well. And then you look at the cholestatic symptoms to support your jaundice.
Yes.
What will be the presentation of Merizzi syndrome?
Ravindra? Madam?
What will be the presentation of
Merizzi
syndrome?
Madam, right upper quadrant pain, jaundice, and fever.
So, how will you know that it is choledocholithiasis or Merizzi?
Madam, we have to get imaging done, madam.
So one is the presentation will be like choledocholithiasis, and imaging will give us some clue that probably you're dealing with a disease. So that can also present as obstructive jaundice depending on the type.
Yes.
But again, fever and abdominal pain will be an important feature. Okay. Based on this, can we, I think that's all will be there in the history. Can you give a differentials at this stage? Let's give you a differentials. You have a patient. The 68-year-old who's come with history of weight loss and loss of appetite for 4 months.
Yes, ma'am.
And followed by progressive jaundice. On this, an absence of pain, there is a passage of pain stool, and absence of pruritus. Yes. So, what are your differentials?
Madam, I would like to give first, I would like to keep it as a obstructive jaundice. Secondary, most probably extra hepatic cause, madam. I would mind in that extra hepatic cause.
When you give an answer for this, first you say it is cholestatic jaundice. My preference is more towards extra hepatic. And my differentials for extra hepatic obstruction are these. I consider extra hepatic obstruction for the following reasons.
Yes.
And then give your differentials. Okay. And there's no comorbidity, I think, and in absence of any comorbidity, or at the performance scale of zero.
Okay. Equals. Okay. First, malignant causes, madam. Malignant causes, it might be distal
Give your differentials in an order.
Distal cholangiocarcinoma, one, madam, and periampullary carcinoma, and pancreatic head carcinoma. Because pancreatic head carcinoma, 10% of the cases can present without the abdominal pain, madam. And the CAG, carcinoma gallbladder.
How would you classify, doctor? This is not the way to describe it. You're giving all the causes. Suppose you have 100 cases of extrahepatic obstruction. For you, you said because of the age. Why do you consider malignancy first?
Madam, one is the age, and another is the almost 4 months it has been going on, madam. And weight loss is there, significant weight loss is also there. And loss of appetite is there.
Can this be chronic pancreatitis with the biliary stricture?
Sir, chronic pancreatitis, he might be having a past history of abdominal pain might be there, sir. But in this case, it is not there. So I am not...
What percentage of patients with chronic pancreatitis will present with severe pain?
I am not sure, sir. But in pancreatic malignancy, 10% of the patients might present...
So chronic pancreatitis is a great masquerader. It can often present with pain which is not really perceived. And they may go on for a long time and present with the sequelae in the form of biliary structure in the form of endocrine insufficiency much later.
Okay.
Yeah. So when you are putting your in your differential of pancreatic head cancer, where only 10% will have pain, 90% are not going to have pain. It is not fair that you leave out chronic pancreatitis.
Okay.
And don't keep something with 90% where it is not going, presentation is with pain. So don't keep it in so higher up as your second differential diagnosis. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So it is when you are, it is a painless jaundice, probably short duration of jaundice and cholestatic jaundice. So you would like to keep extrahepatic cause. In that, you have to keep probably cholangiocarcinoma. You can still have chronic pancreatitis biliary stricture as a possibility.
Okay. Okay.
On your own, it may not be wise to offer pancreatic head cancer. Rather, if at all, an ampullary cancer would proceed than a pancreatic head cancer or a gallbladder cancer.
Okay.
And any medical causes that you can, you would still want to keep? So it can still be a cholestatic phase of
vital hepatitis.
Infective hepatitis that cannot be completely ruled out, because
okay.
You do have some amount of this weight loss and some amount of the prodromal symptoms and cholestatic phase, so you cannot rule it out.
Okay.
So don't rule it out upfront on history.
Okay.
So normally what we would do is we classify it as, so we have 100 cases, then almost what I usually describe is 70-80% will be hilar cholangio. Okay, that's most common.
Okay.
And then the distal will be 10 and the proximal will be 10, that is at the porta.
Okay.
And then the other way of classifying it is, in this particular case, very difficult to differentiate hilar versus the, you can call it as distal carcinomas of the biliary system. Which will include distal cholangio, periampullary, juxtapapillary, and carcinoma head.
Okay.
And in that, in those four, what are the two that will get excluded? Distal cholangio will be out, juxtapapillary will also be out. Okay. Left upper will be only ampullary and carcinoma head.
Okay.
And most of the carcinoma head will invariably, it will all be advanced, pain will be a feature. So therefore, that ampullary carcinoma will be the number two.
Yeah.
So if I were to discuss, then I would say based on the prevalence figures and the presentation of this patient, hilar would be number one and number two would be ampullary. Okay?
Okay.
And gallbladder cancer invariably would present with abdominal pain, which is usually a feature that is described most of the times.
Okay.
But if you have a small fungic growth, you know, and they will not present with pain, or you have say fungic growth which is almost infiltrating the porta, you can get obstructive jaundice, but the pain may not be a feature.
Okay.
Or if you have I don't know, carcinoma, this is steamed up or Hartman's pouch. Again, you can get almost like varices and obstructive jaundice, and pain may not be a feature.
Okay.
So classify it as hilar, distal CBD malignancy. In the distal malignancy, you have four, then hilar is five, then gallbladder is six, and then nodes at the porta due to primary elsewhere.
Yes.
Supposing you have a primary, say, in the pancreas, and there's a secondary there, or it's a stomach. Stomach is most common. Colon may just present as anemia. For all, waiting for a surprise, last week we discussed.
Yes.
Hepatic flexure growth just presenting as obstructive jaundice and anemia. So net will be 4 plus 1, 5, 6, 7. So you have at least 7 causes. In that, you have to put your priority based on the presentation, what you would like to consider as number one. Okay. Dr. Sharunen, you can
just tell us, this is how we,
for the malignancy, just for the malignancy. Dr.
Sharunen? Yeah, so again, if you are in the patient is from northern India, then it would be important to keep gallbladder cancer higher up. And in India, you would want to keep cholangiocarcinoma much lower, and ampullary and pancreatic cancer would be higher. But the first priority will be based on whether it is painless jaundice or painful jaundice. Then next would be based on the geography, and also then you look at the other symptoms.
Okay.
symptoms, where you have chatic symptoms in cholangiocarcinoma, where pruritus and general AD fatigability may be the common presentations. In ampullary cancers, you may have some alteration in the bowel habit. You may have some GI bleed, which may be there. So that can help you. And if there is a waxing and waning of jaundice also, you look at ampullary tumor. And pain is very severe in pancreatic head cancer and gallbladder cancer. So based on this, you can distinguish.
And now, the other important...
The extent of the jaundice and that will be much more faster in pancreatic head cancer and gallbladder cancer. In pancreatic head cancer and gallbladder cancer, it will be a fast progressive jaundice. In cholangiocarcinoma, usually it will reach a plateau and it will be a slow gradual jaundice.
You have to keep other differentials. For example, just the stricture of the distant CVD with stones, you have to keep that. And keep all the other IgG4, etc., all the other differentials. We'll just focus our attention to this because we want to discuss the management. Okay, can we just move on? Next slide. The patient is also a diabetic, okay, and not a hypertensive. Next slide. Just move on. So what are the important things you look for in examination? Quickly tell in 2 or 3 minutes.
One is icterus, madam.
Indeed, and another, yes.
And another is skin changes and the shining nails.
Resorption of
AFib,
yes.
And is there any...
What are the cutaneous markers you're looking
for? Madam, acanthus is nigricans. And another is...
Not acanthus and nigricans. What are the important things to look for in pancreatic cancer? What is it that you look for? Migrating thrombophlebitis. Then you look for the left supracarotid lymph node and nodules. Yeah, so it should come out spontaneously. Okay. So these are the extra things that you look for in this particular patient.
Okay.
So on examination, what are the things you look for in examination of the abdomen?
Abdomen, one is you look for hepatomegaly, gallbladder.
Never say hepatomegaly. You look for a liver.
Liver and gallbladder.
You will palpate for the gallbladder.
And another is spleen.
And spleen. And trop space dullness.
The trop space dullness.
So what are the...
If the spleen is palpable, what does it mean to you?
Spleen is palpable, then they might have gone into the person might have gone into the secondary biliary cirrhosis.
God, not in that. Come on, in this patient here, in this particular patient, the spleen is palpable. When did you suspect secondary biliary cirrhosis? This is where you go take off tangentially. We're talking to this particular patient, your spleen is palpable. What are the possibilities? If it's a pancreatic carcinoma, what can happen?
Okay, madam. Thrombosis.
Thrombosis where?
Thrombosis of the spleen.
Thrombosis vein. Is number one. Number two, can you get portal vein thrombosis in hilar meningio?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
You can get. So therefore, splenomegaly is one.
In other words, you have to look at what are the causes of portal hypertension with jaundice, right? That's what we are trying to look at. Yeah, so which will be the causes of portal hypertension with jaundice, which has presented with this kind of cholestatic jaundice? One is chronic pancreatitis. Chronic pancreatitis itself can cause splenomegaly. Yeah. What about EDH period? Can you get portal
vinopathy EDH period? PCC, yes, sir. Portal cavernoma cholangiopathy can present.
Portal vinopathy? Yes. Yeah. So these two things you have to keep in mind. Pancreatic cancer also can cause, but usually they will be so acute that you don't expect that the patient will develop mainly, and you know you would have expected it to progress much more before that. Yeah.
Okay.
So keep in mind the chronic pancreatitis and EHPVO, extrahepatic portal vein obstruction.
Now, can you give your comments on the liver enlargement in a patient with extrahepatic biliary obstruction? What are the things that can happen to the liver? I'll just cut the story short. So, if you have a massive, suppose the liver is enlarged right up to the umbilicus, then the possibility is more distal the obstruction, larger will be the liver. That's a dictum. More closer the obstruction to the porta, the liver is moderately enlarged. That's number one. Number two, never ever comment on the right lobe and left lobe because you can expect an atrophy-hypertrophy complex. So in simple terms, just say liver is palpable in the midclavicular line and in the midsternal line. Mention the surface, mention the surface and the consistency, etc. So what I want to stress is this that never comment on this. Don't say hepatomegaly. Just in simple terms, don't say left lobe and right lobe. You may be totally wrong. So therefore, in simple terms, just mention about the size of the liver in the epigastrium and in the right hypochondrium. Mention the size as it is seen, and immediately mention the upper border of the liver dullness. You get the liver span. Number one. Number two, gallbladder. What's the importance of palpating for a gallbladder? Two things. One is gallbladder palpable, gallbladder not palpable. So the common question that we asked is, when is gallbladder not palpable in biliary obstruction? Just answer that.
Well, the hilar cholangio, we can GB is not, gallbladder is not palpable in a hilar cholangio.
Who says that? Why do you say that? Gallbladder should not be palpable in hilar cholangio. Can you get a mucocele or something like that? Just with the secretions that is there inside. What is the standard answer for a gallbladder not being palpable in extrapanibillary obstruction?
Stone disease, madam. Gallbladder stone. Stone disease.
Then number one. Number two. Damodar. What are the other causes of gallbladder not being palpable? Damodar. In the patient has got a gallbladder that is in the gallbladder fossa, and you have a gallbladder cancer which is on the undersurface of the liver. Again, it will not be palpable. Understand? And number three is logical answer, post-polycystic knee states. And then again, gallbladder will not be palpable. And if a palpable, so if a gallbladder is palpable, there are several other causes, not necessarily due to a carcinoma head or pancreas. You can get a palpable gallbladder due to empyema, gallstone disease, due to, what would be the presentation in Mirisi's? Gallbladder may not be palpable, depending on the type of the Mirisi's. Okay, so please read Provincial's law. You must know when is it applicable, when it is not applicable. These are standard questions that are asked. Okay. Dr. Sharma?
Yeah, so the most important thing in examination would be to look at whether gallbladder is palpable or not. It tells us whether it is the block is supracystic or infracystic, above the level of the cystic duct or below the level of the cystic duct. And then there are exceptions to the rule, so that we should be aware of. Not all palpable, not all distended gallbladders will be palpable to the fingers. So sometimes it may not be so obvious on examination. And when the icterus is very deep, do look for signs of liver cell failure.
Very important, yeah. And look for free fluid as well.
Yes. And you should know all the mechanisms for each of the manifestations.
Manifestations. You can get ascites. With an lymphatic obstruction in hilar cholangio carcinomas. It may be actually a metastatic liver disease and the patient has got ascites. Okay? So, do not forget to examine the free fluid also in the abdomen. It's very important. Rectal examination is also equally important. So after examination, the differentials remain the same. What can you just tell the differentials now? Liver spleen not palpable, gallbladder not palpable, liver span 11 centimeters. What's the differential? You're in for a surprise, or you still feel that your differentials will remain the same?
It's probably higher. Hilar cholangiocarcinoma.
Yes, hilar. Hilar cholangiocarcinoma is still a possibility. Still what is less likely is a distal. Distal CVD malignancy.
Yes, ma'am.
So distal malignancies is less likely or unlikely. Hilar cholangio carcinoma is most likely. Okay. And maybe there are nodes at the porta, maybe primary elsewhere. The second.
Another important thing that you should not forget in history is, was there any endoscopic intervention? Was there any stenting which was done? So that you should not miss.
Okay.
So if the patient is stented, then the gallbladder will not be palpable. Okay.
And the indication and gallbladder will not be palpable. Okay, so what investigations do you need now in this patient? Just list out, I can allow you to do two important investigations. What are they?
Liver function test.
Yeah, so you call it as liver biochemistry, PTINR. Okay, what else do you ask for? PTINR is not that important to this patient.
Okay. liver biochemistry and ultrasound abdomen.
Ultrasound scan of abdomen. Now, just tell us what do you expect in both of them, then we'll show you the results.
In liver biochemistry, I would expect cholestatic pattern of jaundice, madam. Predominantly direct bilirubin. Bilirubinemia.
So conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. Number two.
And there is raised ALP and GGT. Alkaline phosphatase and GGT, madam.
Marginal elevation of AST, AST, which is less than 100, and an alpha gamma DT will expect a 5 to 10 times elevation is noted. Okay. Yeah, so you're saying you expect a 5 to 10 times
elevation for alpha gamma DT, a marginal elevation of AST, ALT. And maybe you get about 150, but not more than that. Okay. And you will get a conjugated
hyperbilirubinemia. What will be the argument?
Albumin might be low, madam, because
he's
having anorexia.
One is since the disease duration is for 4 months, may have a low albumin. But if the jaundice itself is only for 1 month, 21 days is the usual half-life. So any patient with jaundice, viral hepatitis, if you usually do, albumin will always be normal. But here the duration of illness is 4 months, so you may get a low albumin, number one. Now, what are the findings you need for an ultrasound scan of the abdomen?
Ultrasound scan. Any obstruction, biliary tract, extrahepatic biliary obstruction is there.
See, Ravindra, when a question like they're asking you what findings they're looking for.
Okay. One is the dilatation of intrahepatic biliary radical dilatation, so extrahepatic biliary radical.
When you answer the exam, you will say, I expect upfront dilatation of the intrahepatic biliary radicals, number one. Yes, number two, what's the next thing?
To find out where is the level of obstruction, level of obstruction.
Yes. So you will screen the CBD. You will screen the CBD for a dilatation or an obstruction and the nature of obstruction. Number two. Number three, you will trace the CBD distally for the pancreatic pathology as well for a double duct sign.
Double duct sign.
So there are two, three signs that we look for. One is a double barrel sign is that the CBD is as dilated as the portal vein. Double barrel. Double barrel is the gun barrel.
Yes.
The gun has double barrel. Yes. So we call it as double barrel. Number two, you look for a double duct. Where you have a dilatation of the CBD and the
dilatation of the.
And the third sign is called as the cigar butt sign, BUTT. That is in the distal CBD, it is a suggestive of a distal cholangiocarcinoma. So you look for three signs. And you switch on the Doppler. Why do you want to know this? Switch on the Doppler to look for?
Involvement of the portal vein.
Portal vein thrombosis, because you want to know whether there is involvement of the portal vein or not. Vein you want to study the portal vein thrombosis, plenty vein thrombosis. And then you screen for the gallbladder, look for any stones in the gallbladder, and you screen the spleen and look for minimal free fluid. Okay, so when a question like this is asked, you have to sequentially tell, because people don't do ultrasound. Otherwise, those days, we used to do our own ultrasound for our patients. Okay. Ultrasound will be there in the outpatient clinic. The case will be seen, you go straight to the ultrasound, do the ultrasound ourselves and identify what it is so that you know what you're looking for.
Okay.
All right. Okay, Dr. Sharanan, then we can move on. Any other thing that you would like to highlight?
Yeah, so in ultrasound, you want to confirm whether this gallbladder is really palpable, distended, not distended. Look for intrahepatic biliary radical dilatation, the level of the block, and if you can identify the lesion, the location and the type of the lesion.
Next slide, Bhagavad. So we have a hemoglobin of 9.3. WBC count is 3,500. Platelets are normal. React, urea, electrolytes normal, INR is normal, patient is diabetic, HbA1c is 9. Bilirubin, you can comment on the LFT?
Yes, ma'am. Bilirubin is mixed bilirubinemia. Total bilirubin is 12.19, direct bilirubin is 7.25. The AST, SGOT is 38 and SGPT is 58. Albumin is 3.3.
Just comment, madam,
there's both direct and indirect hyperbilirubinemia is there, madam, in this.
You cannot have both direct and indirect. Predominantly,
which is more?
Predominantly direct.
Is indirect?
Predominantly direct is there, madam, 7.25. And elevation of alkaline phosphatase and GGT is there. It indicates there is an obstruction, madam, cholestatic.
Define direct conjugated?
Sorry, madam.
When will you say it is?
Madam, 15% of the, if direct bilirubin is more than 15% of the total bilirubin, then we will say it is a conjugated bilirubin.
How much is it? Slightly more.
Sorry, madam.
Slightly more, 7.25. That's why
yes,
it makes it.
Okay. But it is more than 15% of the total bilirubin, madam. So there is a direct bilirubin.
Okay. But overall, it looks more like indirect. Okay, gamma GT, your comment on
gamma,
that?
Yes, madam. It is a 240, madam. It is highly elevated.
Yeah.
Normally 60 like that. It is almost four times.
So it depends on the lab. So you have a gamma GT that is elevated. Okay.
Yes,
Dr. Sharma, any comments on this?
Yeah, so basically it indicates the surgical objective beyond this. Cholestatic picture. Total counts are mildly low, otherwise rest everything is fine.
Is it suggestive of extrahepatic obstruction?
Yeah.
Ravindra.
Yes, ma'am.
So,
with a predominant elevation of alkaline phosphatase in GGT, when you don't have very significant transaminase elevation, you can consider this as a surgical jaundice.
Yes.
Okay, the patient did not have an ultrasound, but he came with imaging. So we'll go through the cross-sectional imaging. Next slide. Yeah, can we give your comments on this? I think we have four cuts there.
Is a dilatation of intrahepatic bilirubin radicals.
As well as a CT abdomen or
CT, sorry madam, CT abdomen. It is a cross-sectional image of a CECT abdomen, madam.
Discuss the phase, which phase you're seeing.
It is arterial phase, madam. First one is the arterial phase.
Yeah, keep describing.
Liver surface is regular, madam.
And
Dilatation of intrahepatic biliary radical dilatations, I can see.
In both lobes.
Next is the portal venous phase, madam.
What are you looking for in that?
Is there any portal vein obstruction? Is there
nothing much is seen? Okay. And the last one is the delayed phase. Next slide. Okay, so we have a report here. We didn't have other pictures. So, can just read the report and give your comments, and then we take up the management.
Okay. It is a gross intrahepatic. There is a gross intrahepatic dilatations. Long segment wall thickening and enhancement and narrowing involving the extrahepatic common hepatic duct, common bile duct for a length of 3 cm and distal cystic duct. Noted wall thickening and enhancement involving the ampullary segment of the CBD, intrapancreatic segment of CBD measures 7 mm. There is no lymphadenopathy, no liver or pancreatic lesions. CBD CH stricture is there, madam. Involving the common hepatic duct, extrahepatic common hepatic duct and the CBD and distal cystic duct, which is enhancing. So most probably is malignancy, man, because of enhancement.
Where is the lesion?
Common hepatic duct, in the extrahepatic common hepatic duct and common bile duct, man. It is possible cholangiocarcinoma.
So it appears more like a higher cholangiocarcinoma.
Yes, cholangiocarcinoma.
Okay. Pancreas looks normal.
Pancreas and there is no lymphadenopathy, there is no liver or pancreatic lesions.
Mm-hmm. So,
and vascular involvement, it is not mentioned.
Okay, so Dr. Sharon, you can just take up
from management. So, in the initial pictures which were showed to you, so one, you have to see the intrahepatic biliary radical dilatation, whether it is central or peripheral or it is equal. And then you talk about the transition. Where is the transition seen? And the length of the obstruction. Whether any mass region is appreciated or it is more of a stricture that is appreciated. And so here you can say that it is central more than peripheral. On the periphery, the ducts are not so dilated, but in the central, it is significantly dilated. That again, usually tells us the duration. If the duration increases significantly, you will see that the peripheral dilatation will be equal to the central dilatation. And then in these cuts, we are not able to appreciate. As you come lower down, you want to see where is the transition where the bile duct suddenly collapses. Okay. And another important thing, whenever you are seeing a stricture kind of a lesion, is to describe the length of the stricture, whether it is a long stricture or short stricture. And in chronic pancreatitis, you get benign long strictures. So that just keep that in mind. When you have long strictures, it can be benign. And you have more of eccentric and heterogeneous strictures, which are short segment. They are more likely to be malignant. Okay, but again, they will be more distal. Proximal strictures are more likely to be malignant. But if you are not able to appreciate a very well lesion, definite lesion, then you still have to keep the possibility of IgG4-related cholangitis or a benign disease like primary sclerosing cholangitis, where the dominant stricture that you are seeing, that also is on the cards. So you cannot completely rule out that.
And I think
in this case,
classification is important. You'll have to give a classification. Can you give a classification? You think it's complete bifurcation of the two? Or you think it's a confluence? Is it what type? What would be the classification? You should give a classification, or you want an MRCP for classifying.
This is class 2. It looks like class 2 or 3, but class 2.
Actually, you can't see the lesion, no? Pilar lesion is not seen. What you're seeing is just a dilated. Can we have the next picture, Bhargav? I think we have an MRCP. Let's move on. So, okay. These are the HPSAG. The patient came with a CT. So, that's the picture that they showed you. Viral markers are negative. CA99 is 708. What's your comment on that?
CA99 is elevated, madam, but not grossly elevated. If it is more than 1,000, then we can think of it as end-stage malignancy. If it is more than 1,000, if it is less than 1,000, it is not that much advanced.
Okay, Sharon,
can I ask you questions? Yes, so the CA99 will have a role. As a base, it will have a corroborative role to malignancy. But having said that, if in a jaundiced patient, CA99 is always elevated. So you have to have caution while interpreting a patient with jaundice. Okay, if a patient does not have jaundice and CA99 is elevated, then you are thinking more in terms of malignancy. And a very high level may...
Am
I audible now?
You're audible.
Yeah. So CA99 has to be interpreted with caution in presence of jaundice, because in presence of jaundice, the elevated value may not have much value. So in a non-jaundice patient, it adds more information. A very high value, like about 1,000, you can think of an advanced disease or a metastatic disease. And it is useful for follow-up and surveillance in case of a cancer.
Next slide. So this was the MRCP. You want to interpret that? Quickly interpret.
So narrowing below the attachment of the cystic duct at the level of common bile duct.
Somewhere around the junction of the cystic duct and the CDT. No? That's where the narrowing is there. Seems to be a stricture at that site. Distal CDD seems to be collapsed.
Okay.
So, again, the possibility of a stricture, possibility of a malignancy was considered. And I mean, what should be the management of this patient now, the state of the management?
Another thing that you have to remember is, if suppose that the bile duct is also well dilated, especially above the level, or the texture is a little lower down, keep in the possibility of a colidocal cyst, which has now undergone a malignant transformation, which there is a texture lesion. Okay, in the MRCP, it appears to be more of a mid-CBD kind of a block, because you can see the on the left panel that the volvular is well distended, and to some extent you can even see the cystic duct, and then the dilatation is the structure is seen. It's a short segment structure, and mid-CBD, so most likely it is going to be a mid-CBD cholangiocarcinoma. It's somewhere between the junction of the proximal bile duct and the mid-CBD.
So I think we'll just stop here for this sake. Can we just take up the discussion on management, Dr. Chandler?
So the management is going to be... Actually, we continue later, you're saying, madam?
Yeah, can we just continue with the management to find out malignancy? We'll finish up the discussion on management. So the report, cholangiocarcinoma and IgG4, cholangiopathy or sclerosing cholangitis was the MRCP report. Okay, Bhargav, we can stop sharing the slide. We'll just take up the management from here on. So what should you, how should you manage, Dr. Ravindra? We'll take Dr. Chavanan. I want you to discuss the surgical component, endoscopy with the lead. So we can just finish off the surgical management.
I would like to get a CEC
so chest. In a biliary structure where there is a suspicion of cholangiocarcinoma, so one would be to assess the extent of the disease. So the bismuth classification applies for cholangiocarcinoma as well. So you have to know the bismuth. It's slightly different from that for the biliary structure. So you have to know that. Essentially, we need to know whether the confluence is involved or not, whether there is any extension onto the right side or the left side, and locally the vascular involvement, if there is any involvement of the port of the right or the left portal vein, so that also the correspondingly, is there any atrophy and the hypertrophy of the liver on the right or the left side. If you have ipsilateral portal vein involvement or liver lobe atrophy, then it is still amenable to resection. If you have a contralateral portal vein involvement, and that is the portal vein involvement on the opposite side and the biliary structure on the opposite side, then it becomes unresectable. This is about the loco-regional disease. Then you talk about the distant disease. So for staging, cholangiocarcinomas are not FDG avid, so a PET CT is not recommended. It would be more of a CT abdomen and a CT chest. So once you have ruled out liver metastasis, abdominal metastasis and lung metastasis, the treatment is surgery. And so the treatment is going to be based on whether there is any involvement of the confluence of the right or the left duct. In that case, you would need a liver resection. If there is no involvement of the confluence or the right or the left duct and involvement of only the mid-CBD, then it would need a radical bile duct resection. If there is involvement of the distal bile duct, then it would need a Whipple's pancreatic adenectomy. And the other important thing when you are resecting the liver is whether or not to resect the caudate lobe. If it is on the right side, it would need a right formal right hepatectomy. If it is on the left duct, it would need a formal left hepatectomy. If usually a caudate resection has to be done because of the lymphatic drainage, so that you clear all the lymphatic drain. So it is important to do the caudate resection as well. Only if you have a pure mid-CBD lesion resection and lymphadenectomy alone, without having to resect any liver. Reconstruction in case of bile duct resection would be a hepaticogegenostomy, which will be a Roux-en-Y hepaticogegenostomy. In case of bile duct resection, if it is important to get margins negative on the opposite side. So if after you reset, on the opposite side, you will do a hepatic vaginostomy. If you run a right hepatectomy, you will do a left hepatic. The left bile duct will be used for hepatic vaginostomy. If needed, a frozen section will be done to confirm that the margins are free. And if it is a bile duct tumor, it is important that you resect a little higher up in the bile duct and not just above the cystic duct, so that you get an adequate margin.
So when you do a bile duct dissection,
so that is the surgical management for this.
Dr. Sharon, I just want to know, when you have a bile duct extent, that would be from the hilum up to the distal CBD, is it?
Yes.
It would be a wide dissection.
If it is a mid CBD lesion. If it is a mid CBD lesion, then radical bile duct excision. It would be preferable to do a frozen section of both the sides of the margin, so that if there is any doubt, then you may have to convert it. If you think that the inferior margin is compromised, it may be better to convert that into a Whipple's. If the proximal margin is compromised, then we may have to convert it into a liver resection.
So
if there is a bilobar involvement of the right.
One clarification. Supposing this patient had a lesion below the cystic duct insertion, and when would we consider a Whipple's, you said, when there is extension, is it, distally?
Yeah, when there is an involvement of the distal bile duct.
Bile duct also.
Or when, distal bile duct involvement, or you are doing a resection for a mid-CBD lesion, but when you do the frozen section, you find that there is some extension microscopically. In that case, you have to convert it into Whipple. And if it is a hilar cholangio and there is involvement of both the right and the left duct, it does not become a contraindication for surgery as long as we are able to achieve a negative resection and perform an anastomosis. You can even do central hepatectomies where you remove the central segments, segment 4, segment 8, 5. And you can still, but only thing is you will have multiple anastomosis on the bile duct. So if the
this is what is called
margin free, you just need 1 millimeter margin, that is enough for clearing.
This is what
central hepatectomy. There are different names.
This is called as trisegmentectomy, is it? This one,
trisegmentectomy is usually reserved for a extended right hepatectomy, which is classically performed for especially for carcinoma gallbladder with the bile duct involvement, which encroaches onto the right duct commonly. So that is the trisegmentectomy. This has other names are Taj Mahal resection and mesohepatectomy. These are the other forms of names for the central hepatectomy. Commonly, it would be some combination of segments 8, 5, 4, 4B, 4A. So it would be one of these segments that would be.
Sure. So anyway, for the confirmation in a patient like this, what should we do? Would we go for a resection or should we?
If the imaging features are if this was a younger patient where there is only some wall enhancement that is seen rather than a stricture, and you have not a very high jaundice, then if your differentials are IgG4-related disease, in that, or you are considering a benign stricture, there would be a role of a cholangioscopy or a spyglass. And also, if any node is available nearby, you can also target that by EOS. Otherwise, in such a patient, the resection itself would be both therapeutic as well as it would be diagnostic. So there are situations where we have ended up with a Whipple and then realized that it was the IgG4 disease. But in such situations, it is good to go for a multidisciplinary discussion. Discuss it with the medical gastroenterologist, the surgical oncologist, medical oncologist, everybody discuss together and then take a call. If there is a doubt in a younger patient, less jaundice, same antenna not elevated, I would have opted for a cholangioscopy. Here you are seeing a definite short segment stricture with a significant wall enhancement and high jaundice. So then, and elderly patient, so the chances of malignancy are higher. So here it is okay to proceed directly with surgery.
And we don't need any further test for staging, you know, in a patient like this. So, I mean, this is sufficient. The CT shows no other nodes, nothing else was positive. So, the patient did undergo a radical CVD resection with a Whipple's because there was some evidence in the MRCP to say there was some enhancement of the distal CVD. So, the patient went in for Whipple's with a wide excision of the radical excision of the CVD and with a hepaticodiagnostomy. I think that's what Dr. Senthil had done. And the biopsy came as, Bhargav, what was the biopsy report?
Ma'am, moderately differentiated adenocarcinoma.
That of the hilum, no? Moderately differentiated adenocarcinoma of the CVD, no?
Yes, ma'am.
CVD, yeah. So this was one of the classical cases where the MRCP showed that the lesion was probably extending up to the distant CVD. So we did a wide dissection of the radical dissection of the CBD and did a Whipple's. Probably, Dr. Sharanan, you can just highlight once again, you know, the resections of the liver in such patients, hilum. That's the hilum collision. Can just repeat that? Just summarize it.
Sorry, madam, your voice was breaking. What did you ask? What did you say?
Can you just summarize the resections? In a patient, just summarize the resection in a patient with a hilar cholangio. Summarize.
So the resections are going to be either a formal right hepatectomy, a formal left hepatectomy, a central hepatectomy, a radical bile duct resection, and a pancreaticoduodenectomy. Whenever the liver resection is performed, it is almost always with a caudate lobe resection. It will involve the lymphadenectomy of the entire hepatoduodenal ligament up to the peripancreatic and retropancreatic nodes and up to the celiac level.
I think that's fine. Yeah. So the patient had biopsy excision. That's one. This was the report that we had. I think one metastasis to 1 to 3 regional lymph nodes. So patient had, such patients would require an adjuvant chemotherapy or we observe them?
Yeah, if they have nodal disease, then they would benefit from chemotherapy. Yes.
So I think the students, what they should know is this atrophy-hypertrophy complex. Not to confuse with the portal vein thrombosis on one side and involvement of the bile duct on the other side. And classification of bismuth classification. As the CT is shown, I think you should be able to narrate the bismuth classification as to what it fits in. And as Sir said, in young patients, I think you should do the evaluation so that we don't miss a benign pathology. I think there were a few questions in the chat box. ERCP or brush or cholangioscopy biopsy, yes, that's what Sir said. If it's a younger patient, yes, you have to do that. If the stricture is below the cystic duct insertion, is it still a distal cholangiocarcinoma then rather than perihilar? What's your comment on that? If the lesion is below the cystic duct, would you still call it as hilar, perihilar?
No, it would be more of a distal bile duct lesion.
Distal cholangio. No, it would be more like a distal cholangio. And IgG4 to be considered in old male. I think IgG4 we always consider, you know, all of a sudden, I mean, we have seen quite a few cases, gallbladder malignancy almost, IgG4 case behaving. I think that was in Global Hospital when we did a biopsy came as IgG4 positive. And all along we managed the patient as a gallbladder cancer. And PAIS tools in the history of extrahepatic and intrahepatic, it really does not make much. PAIS tools, as Sir also discussed, it can occur in viral hepatitis. This patient has only PAIS tools. So in absence of pain and pruritus, intrahepatic cholestasis will come as a differential. And vitamin deficiency, yes, since the history is long-standing, you can take it. But in the history of just 1 month jaundice, then there it may not be of much importance. Stenting of the CVD needed to bring the bilirubin. What's your comment on that? you need the bilirubin to come down before surgery. This bilirubin bit that they always ask in the exam.
So that again depends upon two things. One, whether a liver resection is needed or is the patient being planned for a pancreatic Whipple's resection. If a liver resection is needed, again, the final answer would be it depends upon the institute policy. Most surgeons would want a bilirubin of less than 5 if they are contemplating a major liver resection like a right hepatectomy or a left hepatectomy. If it is a Whipple's resection, then you don't need to stentions unless they have cholangitis or it is a slightly bulky tumor where you're contemplating an upfront for prior chemotherapy and then reassessment. So with the bilirubin high, you cannot give chemotherapy. You would want to first give chemo and then bring them down. Or if there is any significant organ dysfunction in terms of coagulopathy, or in terms of renal dysfunction, or they are nutritionally so poor that you don't want to take them up immediately for surgery. So only in these situations you would want to stent them. Otherwise, stenting is not needed. Unless it is a liver resection where you would want it to be around 5.
Or a complicated biliary system with extra biliary system presentation. No? I think that should conclude this. I think, Hina, and please read the lymphatic drainage. This question is often asked, lymphatic drainage of the bile duct. Question is commonly asked, especially for gallbladder cancer. They ask, which are the drains, which are the lymphatics that are involved in gallbladder cancer? That I think we'll take up next week. We may not have a case of gallbladder cancer, Dr. Sharmanan. So I will request just half an hour for pancreatic cancer and half an hour for gallbladder cancer, only the surgical aspect. Next Tuesday or next Wednesday. Is it okay? Then with that, we can conclude. I think we've covered CA stomach, esophagus, all the three types. Carcinoma rectum is important. Colon, we've finished. And I think we've finished high lungs. Only gallbladder cancer and pancreas are remaining. Would you need two sessions for cancer, gallbladder and pancreatic cancer?
Yeah, probably two sessions should be okay, ma'am.
Fine. So just see, Diwali is there the week after
yes,
that.
Ma'am.
Let's have one session next week. We can finish our pancreatic cancer first. And gallbladder cancer does not have much of a surgical aspect, no? That you can just mention it in a few minutes, I think 5-10 minutes. I think let's cover them both next week. Okay? Thank you very much, Dr. Sharmanan, for the nice session. Thank you so much. Good night.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Good night.